Today and welcome back. Today we're going to look into the determinations of the ratio charge to the mass for electrons in Thomson's experiment. At the end of this video, you should be able to describe the motion of a charged particle in the presence of both magnetic and electric field. And then we're going to look few cases to determine the ratio of the charge to the mass for electrons. First, let us review back what we have learned in chapter 12 regarding the electrostatic force. When there's an electron moving into the electric field, we know that there will be an electrostatic force acted on electrons, which will be an outward force in this case. So the electron will move upward in a parabolic motion. Then in the recent topic, we also learned how the electrons behave in a magnetic field. So in this case, we can apply Fleming left-hand rule to determine the directions of the magnetic force, which will be a downward force in this case. So the electron also moving downward in a parabolic motions. Now we're going to combine both magnetic and electric field. That when we have electrons in this case, so there will be three possible outcomes here. First, the electron will move in a horizontal motions that the vertical resultant force is equal to zero. This means that the magnetic force is equal to the electrostatic force. So we can substitute the formula of the magnetic force and the electrostatic force that QVB equal to QE, and then we can obtain that the velocity of the electron to move horizontally must equal to the ratio of the electric field strength to the magnetic field strength. Second possible outcomes is that electron is moving in outward directions. This is due to the magnetic force is less than the electrostatic force. And then we substitute both of the formula and we obtain that the velocity of the electrons to move outward in this case is less than the ratio of the E to B. Third cases is that electron is moving downward, that it is opposite to the second case. The magnetic force now is larger than the electrostatic force, so the velocity of the electrons is more than the ratio of the E to B. In short, in the presence of both magnetic and electric field, the resultant motions of the electrons is depending on the velocity itself. So in chapter 12, I have discussed about the productions of the cathode ray. From the discussion, when the electron is moving from the cathode to the anode, the electron is losing its electrical potential energy while gaining the kinetic energy. Based on the conservations of the energy, the loss in electrical potential energy is converted to the kinetic energy. Substitute the formula of the potential and the kinetic energy, we have the equations of EV equal to half mv squared. And from here, we obtain the expressions of the velocity is equal to the square root of 2EV divided by m. And then when the electrons is moving into the regions with the electric field and the magnetic field, if the electrons able to move in a horizontal line, it means that the magnetic force is equal to the electrostatic force. The velocity of the electrons is equal to the ratio of the electric field strength to the magnetic field strength. And then we substitute the formula of the velocity. And here we could derive the expressions of the charge to the mass, which is equal to E squared divided by 2B squared V. So these derivations has tested in 2017. So you can check back on the questions and do the derivations again. Besides the Thomson experiment, we also can use the mass spectrometer to determine the ratio of the charge to the mass. So now we're going to visit again the questions that I've discussed before, which is the trial from Yuhua. So I will put a link on top to these questions if you want to do revision about it. So now we're going to derive the expression of the charge to the mass. So when the charge passing through the velocity selector enter a second region, I've explained that the charge experiences a magnetic force, which is also the centripetal force that causes it to move in a circular motions. So substitute the formula, we have the equations of QVB equal to mv squared over r. And then we rearrange the equations, we can obtain the expression of the charge to the mass equal to the V divided by V2r. And then we can also substitute the formula of the velocity, which is the ratio of the E to V1. And then finally, we can have a different expression of the charge to the mass, which is equal to the E divided by V1, V2R in this case. So now let us try explore deeper into the derivations. Let's say the velocity of the charge is provided a voltage source. From the previous discussion, we have derived that the velocity is equal to the square root of 2QV divided by M. So instead of using the formula of V equal to E per V, so now you can use a different equation that the velocity is equal to the square root of 2QV divided by M. So rearrange the equations. So we can get the third equations for the charge per mass, which is equal to 2b divided by the square of b2r. So up to this point, we have learned about the three equations for the charge to the mass. My advice to this topic is don't memorize the equations, but you need to understand how we do the derivations. To summarize everything that we have learned in this topic, first of all, the velocity of the electron is provided by the electrical potential energy. From the example of the production of the cathode ray, we can derive the velocity of the electron is equal to the square root of 2qb divided by m. Second, when the charge enters a velocity selector, so there are three possible outcomes that we need to review. Either the velocity is equal, less than, or greater than the ratio of the electric field strength to the magnetic field strength. If the electron doesn't move in a horizontal line, you can refer to a case study that I've done regarding the effect of electric field on the cathode ray to do the derivations. And then if the electron is able to move horizontally and enter a second region with the magnetic field, so we learned that the electrons will move in a circular motions. So we have the equations of the magnetic force equal to qvb, while the centripetal force is equal to mv squared over r. So you just need to remember all the basic formula and understand what is happening in the questions to do the derivations. So if you have any interesting scenario or questions regarding this topic, you can send it to me using a Google form below. If I receive any interesting inquiry, I can do a video to discuss further about the derivations. So that's conclude my discussion for today. So you need to practice more to master the derivations. If you have any questions, you can leave it in the comment section below. So do leave a like, share my video, and subscribe my channel. I'll see you in my next video. Thank you.